Hi everyone. In today's video, I want to talk about debugging your Java code within the IntelliJ IDE. The first thing that most newer programmers think of when they are debugging is, oh, let me just throw print statements everywhere. I'll figure out what all my variables are and then I can debug my code, right? Well, that can sometimes work, but first of all, there are much more efficient ways to do it. And second of all, sometimes adding print statements in your code actually changes the behavior of your code and then you're thinking, what is going on? So that's where a debugger comes in. Let's go ahead and pull up IntelliJ, and I'll go through a few examples of how you can use the debugger to debug some code. All right, so in IntelliJ, I've got a main class whose main method is just doing some very basic arithmetic here. I've got two integers, A and B. I'm multiplying them together, and I'm comparing the product of those two integers with another variable, C. And then I am printing out whether it's bigger or smaller. Now, this program really shouldn't have very many bugs in it. If you look at it, you would expect it to print smaller because 2 times 5 is 10, which is less than 11, not greater. And we'd think that we'd always print smaller in this case. Let me run the code just to double check that. And as we expect, when we run the code, we hit the smaller case here. We print smaller. Let's say that I move this to a value of 10, though, and then I rerun the code. So it still prints smaller, even though actually the values should be equal because 2 times 5 is 10. Now, let's say the program weren't this simple and I was trying to figure out why I was getting a value of smaller rather than equal or something else. What you might think you would do is you would add a print statement in here. You'd say debug, and then you'd print out A times B. Then you'd run the code and you would check to see what the print statement said, and yeah, that could work. Or what you could do is you could run this code through a debugger and you could see what the value of each variable is and you can literally step through the program. So the first thing you do that is you need to run in debug mode. And there's this little bug symbol in the IDE. You might think if you run this that that's really debug mode, but that's really not debug mode. That's just turning on additional features in the IDE that then you need to customize to really debug your program. Many, many people click the little debug icon within the IDE. They don't see any different result in their program, and then they kind of throw up their hands saying, okay, that didn't work. Now what do I do? Well, if you're frustrated, you've come to the right place. Let me talk through what you do when you are debugging your code in debug mode. There's more to it than just hitting that little bug icon. The first thing we want to do is we want to insert what's called a breakpoint. A breakpoint is where, while you're running in debug mode, the IDE will stop execution of your program at your breakpoint, and then you can kind of poke around and see what the state of your program is at that breakpoint. So all you have to do to add a breakpoint is, in IntelliJ, you just click right here next to the line number of where you want the breakpoint to start. So basically, before this line of code is executed, we're going to have the IDE stop execution of the program. So if I run with the debug icon again, we'll see what that does. Whoa, okay, so what's going on here? This is the debug window. You're used to normally seeing the console output, which is standard out. In this case, we have a debug window, which is saying what the state of our program is. So this little check mark says that we did hit the breakpoint right here. And this line is highlighted because we're currently on that breakpoint. And it even says right here, main. So we're at line 3. So we're right here. And it says that the only variable which is set right now is this args array. And that's because the args array is right here. It's an argument that goes into the main method. And because we haven't executed this line of code yet, the debugger doesn't know about the A variable yet. So what you have to do is you want to do what's called a step, which means you want to execute the next line of code and then see what happens. So there are these different arrows right here. What you want to do is you want to do a step over. And look at that. We just ran step over. And since we weren't going further into what's called the call stack, we basically just went to the next line of code. So even though our breakpoint was at line 3, we are now still breaking at line 4 here, and we can see that our value of A is 2. So if I skip one more time here, now our value of B is 5. So I can skip a few times. And now I can see that A is 2, B is 5, and A times B equals 10. C equals 10, A times B equals 10. And it's already telling me what's going to happen. I'm going to hit the else block. And here we print out smaller. So look at that. We were able to literally step by step follow the logic through our program, and we were able to look at what it was doing based off of the values of our variables. That's pretty neat, huh? So now that I know how the program would execute in that situation, I'm gonna go ahead and rerun the debugger by clicking on the bug again. And now we're back to where we started. We're back at line 3. So now that I've stepped over, I have A equal to 2, and the code would interact the same way it did last time. Now, let's say that I wanna see how the code would react if A were a different value. You might think you need to change the value of A, recompile, rerun your code, rerun the debugger. Nope, you don't have to do that. You can set the values of the variables while the debugger is running. So now I can literally click on this little arrow, set value, and I'm going to set a value to 9. Now I could step through the code again. I'll go ahead and just do that here pretty quickly. So we can see at this time we're not even going to hit the else branch, because our value of A is 9, which means that our product is 45, which is greater than 10. And now that I know that I'm gonna enter this if statement, I'm just gonna go ahead and hit resume here. And we print out the value bigger. So now let's say I'm debugging this code and I want to specifically look for when I'm hitting this else case, but really the value isn't smaller, it's equal. What I can do is I can add a breakpoint and I can evaluate A times B relative to C. I currently have a breakpoint still at line 3, and now I'm gonna add one at line 8, and then I'm gonna right click on it, and I'm going to add a condition. Now I'm going to say A times B equals C. So now what'll happen is this breakpoint will only get hit if the condition is true. And in the case of the code right now, I would expect it to be true. So we've hit our first breakpoint. I don't want to step over each line, so I'm gonna hit resume. And now we can see that we've hit our second breakpoint and our value of C and A times B are exactly the same, and that's why we hit it. If I were to rerun the debugger and then I change the value of A to 3, then if I resume, we can see that we just hit bigger here and we don't hit this second breakpoint. So that's pretty sweet. You can make a breakpoint conditional based off of the state of your program so that you don't hit it every single time. Let's say that this first breakpoint's annoying me and I don't want to use it anymore, but I want to generally keep it in place. I can right click on it and I can deselect the enabled. And what this means is I have a breakpoint here I could turn back on, but it's not currently enabled. And we'll see that if I rerun the debugger, that I hit my conditional breakpoint because the two values are the same, but I skipped over the first breakpoint. So next, what I'm gonna do is instead of primitives, now I'm going to convert this to using some objects and demonstrate how you could use objects in a debugger. All right, so here's some more code where I've got strings and I am adding things into a list and then I'm printing the list. So you may look at this code and you may see the bug immediately, or maybe you don't. Let's go ahead and run it and see what it's doing. Ah, we have a bug. Looks like we have a string index out of bounds exception, and it happens right here with substring. So based on the fact that we're throwing that exception here, you might pretty quickly draw the conclusion that the strings within my list are not long enough. And you'd be correct when you take a look at this string, for example. But let's say it weren't that straightforward and you didn't see the contents of my list. You could print out my list ahead of time if you wanted to, or you could add in some breakpoints. Let's go ahead and run this with the debugger and see what it looks like. All right, so now that we're in the for loop, this is the first time that we're in the for loop because we don't have a conditional breakpoint. You can see here that these are all the active variables. We can see that my list has a size of 3, whereas second list currently doesn't have any elements in it because we haven't added anything. And the current value of my string is hello. And we could even see right here, we just use this little caret. We can see what the entire contents of my list are. I've got hello there, yo. And I can just keep drilling down as to what the details of all of this information is. This is really valuable. You can get down to pretty low level details in the debugger pretty quickly with what your variables are doing and what state they're in. So if I were running the debugger, I could immediately, after adding this breakpoint, if I didn't have access to my list originally, or let's say it was a complex data structure, I could look through the contents in this debugger and I could tell almost immediately why it would fail my check. And for me, this sort of thing is really useful. Way more useful than rerunning your code twice, five times, 10 times, whatever it is, adding in the magic log statement that tells you where your code's going wrong. It's a lot faster and easier to use a debugger in a situation like this. So now that we've talked about debugging primitives and objects, let's talk about how you could debug when you have multiple threads involved. I'm going to write a small program that hangs when you run it, and I'm going to show with a debugger that you can tell what the state of your various threads are when it enters that hung state. All right, so I've got some code here that has two object monitors that I'm going to be locking. I've got one thread here that I'm starting and another thread that I'm starting. The only difference between these two threads is the order in which they are trying to call synchronized. So the first thread is synchronizing on the first object, then it sleeps for a second, and then it tries to synchronize on the second object. So basically it's trying to acquire the monitor of object and then acquire the monitor of object two. And then this thread is trying to acquire the monitor of object two, sleeping for a second, and then object one. So think about that for a second. Basically, we have two threads that are each starting by acquiring one monitor, and then they each try to acquire each other's monitors after sleeping for a second. So this is what's called a deadlock, because no thread can move forward and they essentially get stuck there indefinitely. If I run this in regular run, we can see here that the code is just going to sit here indefinitely. We could wait here for 10 minutes, we could wait here for 10 hours, doesn't make a difference. These threads are never going to exit, and this is really bad. It's called a deadlock. And this is sometimes very difficult to debug in your code, because where do you start? You could throw in logs kind of in random places and guess where the deadlock is happening, or you could use a debugger and you could find the answer much faster. Let's go ahead and run this in debug mode. And now what I want to do is I want to go down to these little icons down here and I want to get the thread dump. So if I click on that and I raise this up, there's a lot of information here. So these are all of the different threads that are currently running at the time of when we requested that the debugger gave us the thread dump. There is a finalizer, a reference handler, signal dispatcher. A lot of this stuff is stuff that is normally running by the Java Virtual Machine, the JVM, for you, and you don't need to worry about it. But you'll notice there are two right here that are very interesting, each saying waiting for monitor entry. So each of these two threads is seeking entry to a block of code that is blocked by monitor. So that looks promising. So if we click on the first one, we can see that we have a blocked thread because it's waiting on monitor entry. Waiting for thread 755 right here to release lock 2FC, a Java lang object here on line 13 of our code. And then likewise, if we click on 755, we can see that 755 is also waiting for monitor entry because it's waiting on a monitor that 751 has. So interesting. So without needing to add any extra logging or needing to do really much of anything, we were able to deduce that threads 755 and 751 are deadlocked on each other and therefore they're blocking our program. Pretty sweet, huh? And that was a quick overview of using IntelliJ's debugger. I hope I convinced you that that debugger is really, really useful. And it's a lot better than just adding print statements wherever you need to add debug. Don't get me wrong, I debug with print statements quite a bit still. Sometimes it's just not feasible to run a debugger in your environment. But when you do have a debugger available, 100% you should use it where it makes sense, because it just makes your life so much easier. You can change the values of your variables. You can change the behavior of your program. You can do thread dumps like I was just demonstrating. I mean, the options are pretty extensive. If you learned something new today, please do give this video a thumbs up. Drop a comment if you enjoyed the content of today's video. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.